semi-regular variable stars is another stage that these massive stars go through as they go towards the supernova event. Semi-regular variables are just that. They have some periodicity sometimes, and then other times they don't. And it's not periodic, but you can see that it's got some regularity to it. Alpha Orionis, Betelgeuse, is a semi-regular variable star. The other stars are not. We already said that Delta Cep is a Cepheid variable star. A Wolf-Rayet star is sort of a flare star. It doesn't really fit any of the defined categories. And Antares has little or no regularity whatsoever. But some of this actually is the light curve for Alpha Orionis. One of the type 2 supernova remnants deep sky objects this year is Cassiopeia. This one is energy, so this is a completely X-ray image. The blue and purplish is the high energy iron part of it. The green, the sort of the medium energy silicon areas. And you can see it has an outer shock wave, an inner shock wave. It has a neutron star in the center, which they have just discovered recently, evidence that it has superfluidicity in the core. First time that's ever been detected in the core of a neutron star. Another type 2 supernova event. This one is in the Small Magellanic Cloud. Again, this one is an optical image from a ground-based telescope in Chile. And if you add the X-ray image to it and put them together, this pulsar shows up very nicely. This is the very first observed, detected pulsar in the Small Magellanic Cloud, and this supernova event is very close to the star formation region. M1, the Crab Nebula, which of course is not a nebula, it's really a type 2 supernova remnant, with a very active pulsar in the center. This is an X-ray image of the pulsar, because pulsars emit very strongly in X-ray, very weak in the optical. On the Chandra website, there is a time-lapse movie, and you can watch the shock wave moving from the surface of the pulsar to the outside of the accretion disk surrounding it, and you can see the antimatter-matter particles as they are emitted along the rotational axis. Another type 2 supernova event. This is actually three. This is a close-up. Again, we're in the Small Magellanic Cloud again, and these are three supernova remnants that are being studied in this particular area because they are sort of getting together and forming a super bubble around them. And you can see every one of these circular objects is a supernova remnant. So supernovas do happen very often. They're quite common. We just do not see them as well in our own galaxy because the gas and the dust in the plane of the galaxy prevents us from finding them. SN2010JL is another supernova remnant. Again, this is a Chandra image, and this is the very first time. Now, theory has been telling us for years now that when the star collapses and the core rebounds, it produces a shock wave. That shock wave moves out through the material that has been left behind in the star as it was collapsing, and it gets to the edge of that material. It transcends the boundary of the material into the interstellar medium. At that point, it emits a lot of X-rays and generates a back wave, shock wave that travels back. And so you have the forward moving shock wave, the backward moving shock wave, and this is the very first time we've had direct evidence. This happened, this event was caught about 1 month after the collapse, and you can actually, it is actually at the point where you can see that the shock wave is actually leaving the dust and debris around the star and traveling through it into the interstellar medium and producing a lot of X-rays. This is a pulsar. This is not part of the pulsar. This is a background galaxy, but this little purple blob in the middle is a lonely little isolated pulsar that no longer has a remnant around it. It's traveling through space at about 440,000 miles an hour. It's a geriatric pulsar. It is close to the pulsar deadline. It's pretty active for an old guy and still producing enough X-rays that it was detected, but pretty soon it won't be producing X-rays anymore, and then you'd only be able to see it if you could find it with ultraviolet. And here is one of the X-ray binaries. This one shows stellar winds carrying material away from the accretion disk around the black hole in this binary system. And sometimes it has been discovered that sometimes you can see winds carrying material away from the accretion disk in a black hole. And other times you can see that there is no stellar wind coming from the accretion disk, but there are those jets of material along the rotational axis. So it's not known whether the winds shut down the jets or the jets appear and shut down the winds, but there seems to be some kind of a mechanism, a balancing mechanism in place here that limits the size of a black hole. And of course, SIGX-1, because that was the very first suspected black hole object back in the 60s, now of course has been studied for decades, and it definitely is a stellar mass black hole. It's about 15 solar mass black hole with a companion star. Spectroscopy, you need to be familiar with and knowledgeable about spectroscopy, because it is because of spectroscopy, the information we get from that, that's how we place stars on the HR diagram. That tells us their evolutionary stage, their chemical composition, their temperature, and therefore what their previous stages have been and what their future is going to be. Each one here is the spectra for the Sun, for Arcturus, and for Procyon. As you glance among them, you don't see a huge amount of difference in these spectra, but there are differences. If you printed this spectra out on an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper and then cut out every single one of these little strips and glued them together, it would be 55 feet long. When you see a spectra in a textbook, it's like taking 55 feet of spectral lines and jamming them down into 11 inches. And so these are actually a gross cartoon with only the major absorption lines on them, because remember that we're just talking the optical part of the spectrum, which is a very small part of the total radiation emitted by stars. So here's Procyon F5, and this is what it looks like if they had this spectra in a book. Well, you're used to the spectral images that have absorption lines, but if you turn this spectral image and look at it sideways underneath, you would actually see the absorption lines here. And you need to have a spectral plot to do any kind of calculations, because this way it's very easy to bring each one of those absorption lines down to the x-axis where you have the wavelength, and then you would be able to determine the wavelength of each one of those absorption lines. And of course, each one of those absorption lines has a specific wavelength, which is specific to a specific element, whether it's neutral or ionized. So you can overlay the spectral plot on top of the spectral image, and you can see